We're going to talk about configuration management today, and especially and related to using it in cloud environments, because that makes a lot of sense if you ask me. So let me get a quick background about my audience today. Who's actually already using configuration management? Could you please raise your hand? A couple of my friends over there, but they're cheating. They're just checking out how am I doing today. So that's going to be fun. So let me check the other guys. Are you interested in getting to know how to get started with configuration management? Yes, a lot of yes over there. So that's pretty cool. I'm going to help you with that today. Sooner or later, you're going to have to explain to a non-technical person like a manager or a team lead or maybe a colleague or something what configuration management actually does. And that can be quite a challenge. I know that from experience. So I found this funny image that I'm about to show you that really helped me explaining configuration management to managers. What it actually does is when you have configured in configuration management, the setting to be turned on, and whatever happens, somebody turns it off, it will turn it off again. Just make sure it has a consistent state. So that's actually quite funny. And it's more complicated in real life, of course, but this really helps in explaining the stuff. So what are we going to talk about today? The story today is about the why and the how of configuration management. I'm going to tell you three reasons why I think it makes perfect sense to use configuration management. And then we're going to switch to how to actually do that, because I've worked with different teams, and usually they say they have no time to do it. So I'm going to help you getting started with that anyway, and show you the five steps that you need to take to actually get things started. But before we dive into that, let me introduce myself. My name is Remy Bergsma. I'm an engineer that loves building and managing infrastructure based on open source technologies. And it's my goal to automate what can be automated so everything works rock solid, and I have the time to explore new tools and techniques to do other stuff. And the funny thing is that usually results in even better automation, so that's a win-win situation. I'm from the Netherlands, which is in Europe, and for the guys that don't know that, other side of the world at the moment. I did a bachelor in computer science and then worked at internet service providers and even at a semi-government organization. I started using Cloud Stack in early 2012, and I really love it ever since because it's a very cool product. So nowadays I'm working at Schubert Philis, which is a mission-critical outsourcing company in the Netherlands, and we're using Cloud Stack a lot over there as well for our mission-critical environments. So let's talk a little bit about Cloud Stack. What I really like about Cloud Stack is that it has a very powerful API. And in fact, if you're using the UI, all it does is sending the API calls for you. So it's not something extra, it's core functionality. And that makes it very powerful. So anything you can do with the UI, you can also do with the API. And that allows you to create all kinds of scripts to do automated deployments and to create a server, tear it down again, create a network, and everything that's needed. And Cloud Stack is about the infrastructure. It's infrastructure as a service, so it takes care about networking, storage, everything to get actually the server up and running. But once you're there, once the server is actually running, you're pretty much on your own, but Cloud Stack is not going to help you any further because the infrastructure is all done, and then you have to configure it manually or do some other smart stuff, and that's, of course, configuration management. So let me give you an example of how that looks. I hope maybe you can do the little bit of lights. The Lego man down there, let's see if this works. Oh, sorry. Which is down there. Is sending an API call to the Cloud Stack environment. He already has two servers, and now he wants to have a new server, so that's server number three. And he sends an API call and then says, well, man, create me another server. And then Cloud Stack replies, those are the blue lines, well, everything is done, your server is booting. And actually, you can see it at the top over there. You can either boot a new server by an ISO or a template, and then you're going to have to push the buttons, because either you're going to have to install manually or use a template, and then you end up with all kind of the same server. So the point is, when the cloud is about scalability and automation and growing your environment, it's not going to really make a lot of sense when you have to configure your servers manually, because Now he's scaling from 2 to 3 servers, so probably no problem to do that manually. Still a bad idea, but anyway. But what if you want to scale to 10 or 100, maybe 1,000 servers? It makes no sense in creating 1,000 servers manually. How many people would you need to do that if you want to finish by the end of the day? It's going to be impossible. So the first reason is that manual work is not scalable. It just doesn't scale. So you shouldn't be doing it in a cloud environment. Also, if you have a lot of manual work involved, what if something fails? We've, in the industry, tried to come up with all kind of smart stuff to prevent failure from happening. But let's face it, eventually, things are going to fail anyway. So better prepare for that. So if you have servers running in the cloud and one of them fails, or two of them fails, and you have configured everything manually, what are you going to do? It's going to be a lot of time to actually recover from that. So your disaster recovery times are going to be quite long. It just takes too long. If you have configuration management in place, all you had to do is probably just use 2 API calls, one to get rid of the old one and another one to create a new server. Configuration management kicks in, and then you have your web server back. So that really speeds up the stuff. Another side of the story is that to use manual work, you're probably going to document a lot of stuff. So if you create a new server, like a new web server or something, you need to document what exactly you need to do. Because if you have 3 or 4 web servers or 100, and you configure them all manually, how are you going to make sure they're all the same? And usually, installing the first couple of servers is going to be fine. But then later on, there's a change. You need an extra module or something. So then you're going to install an extra server, and who's going to think about that one module that was installed later on? Probably going to forget about it, and then that will lead to some other failure. So who of you guys really likes writing documentation on exactly how your server is configured? Who likes to update it, and who likes to keep it consistent all the time? I see no hands, so probably you guys don't like it. So there are probably no up-to-date documentation. So if you're doing a lot of manual work and something fails, it's not going to really help you. So you have to figure out, under really stressed conditions, how to do the recovery. If you would use configuration management, there was no need to write the documentation for your configuration, because you already documented in the configuration management tool. So you define in configuration management exactly how a server should look like, what properties it has, what users, what's going to be installed, etc. And then it doesn't really matter if you create 1, 10, or 100 of them, because it's all going to be the same. It's getting even better if you want to change settings later on. So if you have this request to install extra modules, you're going to update your configuration management documentation, of a configuration management system, and that will deploy it to all of your web servers. Even if they're offline or whatever, it would just be the same. So my point actually is, you should really use configuration management when you're working in a cloud environment, if you're working with CloudSec or other clouds, because it just doesn't make sense to do it all manually. So I'm going to tell you how exactly we're going to, how you can start using it. But the thing is that usually people say they have no time to start using configuration management because they are too busy doing manual work. And I find that quite ironic, actually. So let's have a look at this next picture. This is probably the problem that we're facing. And I actually think it's true. We are probably too busy to improve. And configuration management is not something new. It is not invented last year or something. The first version of CF Engine, written by Mark Burgess, was released in 1993. So it's 2 decades ago that we have configuration management. And of course, the world changed a lot, and things are different now. There wasn't even a cloud back then. But still, we're not able to use it, because a lot of things are still being done manually. So what we need to do is change a little bit of the priorities in your team's work. So we're gonna change be a little bit smarter in what you're doing in your team, so that will really help you in getting started with this thing. Now, the most frequently asked question about the configuration management stuff, when I talk about that, is usually, which one is the best? Which tool should I choose? Which one should I take? Well, actually, it's pretty much like this. Who of those guys is the best? You tell me. It doesn't really matter. They're all pretty good at what they're doing. And it's the same with the configuration management tools as well. Any of the major tools is perfectly capable of delivering what it should do, keeping up to date with your configuration. So if you ask me, it's more important to actually get started on this thing than to spend your time on trying to figure out which one is the best. And there can be specific situations where choices might be restricted. I once worked in an organization that had a lot of Java application servers, and their memory had been tweaked and tuned, and there wasn't much room for configuration management back then. We weren't allowed to change anything, but still had to implement it. And then we looked at the memory footprint, and it turned out that CF Engine 3 had a very low memory footprint, so that was an obvious choice to use back then. It's a pretty good tool as well. But if you have a greenfield situation, if you start using a cloud, it doesn't really matter which one you're going to choose. It's more important to actually get started. So how are we going to start this thing? Like I said, we need to be a little bit smarter in what things we do on our daily basis, in our jobs. And what I would advise you to do in the first step is to identify your, what I call, time eaters. And a time eater is something that occurs on a regular basis, that comes back a lot of times, that you're spending your time on and getting actually nothing in return. You probably have like a list of problems that that have common solutions or that come back more or less. To give you an example of what I came across, I worked in a team that had automated the deployment of servers pretty well. And one of the things that got installed was a postfix mailer, pretty basic. There were just web applications that were sending email. And then there was an error in the configuration, but they didn't really figure it out until they had deployed a couple of hundred of those servers already, and they couldn't just replace them all. So they quickly fixed the installation procedure, so Neil's servers got now the correct configuration deployed, so that worked. And the others, they actually didn't do anything about it. You just would wait for calls to pop in. So actually, we had like two or three calls every day saying, hey, man, I'm trying to send an email with this application. It's not working. Could you have a look? Well, it came back very often. And what we had to do was just SSH to the server, become root, then change postfix reload. But since it was a ticket, we also had to communicate with the user, test and verify if everything was working, then write hours, close the ticket, all kind of crap. So that took a lot of time. And that really was a time eater. So you should get rid of those kind of stuff. I would advise you to look at, let's say, the top five of your time eaters, the top five of the problems that occur the most often in your organization or that take the most time. Because this top five, we're going to quick fix. We're going to think of something that to get rid of them. And in the postfix example I just gave you, we just wrote a quick bash script. It took 2 or 3 hours to figure out what exactly had to be changed, all the exceptions in the different environments, and then run it, and we're done. So that had a very quick return on investment. So sometimes it's not that easy just to figure it out and to stop doing all this manual stuff. Another quick fix usually is to install the latest patch levels everywhere, because probably you're going to hit bugs that are already been solved. So it's quite useless by working around them or debugging everything. Well, actually installing those is going to save you a lot of time as well. I've seen that happening. It's a real time eater and time saver just to fix it. So now that you're working with that, with the time eaters, there's, of course, you're working with your team and to see what's actually going on. But you probably have users as well that are using their systems. And it's interesting to involve them in the process, because that might lead to unexpected positive results. So there we've got the users. So what we did in involving them was just ask them, well, how can we make this easier for you by using our systems? And one guy came up and said, well, you know, we have 5 different flavors of Linux running. So every time I log into a server, I first have to figure out which flavor this is running. And don't worry, I know how to do that, some grabs and searches and stuff, but it's boring, it doesn't really make sense. So can we fix that? And actually, at the time, we didn't even realize that it would save time later on, because it was only in configuration management like 10 or 20 lines of code to actually come up with something to fix it. Because what we did was create a message of the day that actually would say, hey, you're on Red Hat 6.5. This is a production server, so you probably should not be here. And then this is a virtual machine and some other extra information. And that really made our users happy. And you know why this actually saved time? Because we used to get a lot of calls that says, well, you know, this is kind of weird, but sometimes it works, and then, yeah, sometimes it doesn't. We don't know. Could you have a look with a certain problem? And once we had implemented this kind of stuff, we would get calls like, hey, it's working on Red Hat 5, but not on Red Hat 6. Could you please fix it? So it really it narrowed down the information. Only by presenting it to the user, it saved time in figuring out what exactly they were meaning and how we got to fix it. So let's go back to the steps. So we have quick fixed some issues, we've evolved users and saved some time with that, so it's about time to implement configuration management. So pick one of your tools, the tools that are available, and get started. It might be wise to do like a one-day training or get a seminar or whatever to get things rolling and started, because that really speeds up the knowledge that you have. You can also choose tools that people you know are using. So if somebody you know is using Puppet or Chef, choose the same tool, because you can work together and learn from each other. That's going to help you very much. So then what I would advise you to do is create a baseline. And a baseline is a set of configuration items, like maybe 5 different items, that are more or less the same on all of your servers. So you can think of the root password. If you have Linux servers, every server has a root password. So you can manage it with configuration management. You can manage the SSH configuration. That's pretty much the same. You should disable root logins, if you ask me, now that you're working on that. Implement sudo NTP configurations. All kind of generic, easy stuff like that is nice to get started with. Because it's either on all of your servers, so you have a very very big reach on that. And what also happens is that those are not too easy, not too difficult to start with. I mean, the SSH configuration isn't too hard. So start with the easy stuff. And that's what I call creating the baseline. When you're creating the baseline and getting started with configuration management, please bear in mind that you always should version your code. So implement Git or some other tool that you would like to use for that and get started with version control, because this is getting very powerful. And if you have no idea what's going to change, what changed in your environment, well, you're pretty blind in your infrastructure and your server. So always use version control. And you can make it as complex if you want. And if you use one of the enterprise tools, this is very nicely integrated, but you can also build it yourself. Always version your code, very important. So then it's time to scale. And I would start scaling the baseline out to all of your servers. So start with a few, then add more, and try to reach 100%. If you can't do it in a few exceptions, then that's okay. But try to reach the baseline on all of your servers. And the good thing about that is that it actually creates a very powerful tool from that point on. Because the next thing we're going to do is to scale up. We're going to add configuration items to the mix, and we're going to make sure that we add new stuff. So to refer back to the postfix configuration, we quick fix that pretty ugly. And the next step is to scale up, to add the configuration management code for postfix so that everything would be kept the same. And once the relay had to be changed again, it would be just one commit. We had to deploy it, and it would be fun. So that's very important. And this is how you can eventually automate almost everything. And if you start with the most common configuration item. So if you have a lot of web servers, it makes sense to start with Apache or Nginx or whatever you're using. And then that's going to save a lot of time. The more difficult stuff, you can safely put on the end of your list, because you're going to save a lot of time already. And then you have the time to build that. So eventually, this is going to lead to the situation that you have full control over your situation, and that you either can relax, because everything is automated. You just have to watch a few things, and then everything is going to be very much fun. The other side of the story is that, well, to be honest, you might get bored because everything is automated. So what you should do is then refine your goals and look for new challenges and watch for other things to do. And when I was at the previous CloudSec collaboration conference in Amsterdam, I attended a talk by Chris Buitaert, and he was talking about the future of system administration. And in this talk, he quoted someone from Google that said, every 18 months, you should automate yourself out of your job, which I think is very cool. And you should not worry too much about your job part, because it tries to say that whatever it is that you're doing manually today, you probably shouldn't be doing in 18 months from now. So that should be the goal in doing that. And by doing that, you'll see your job will evolve to be more interesting, actually. So people think they will lose their job, but in fact, all what happens is that you get a more interesting job in return. So that's pretty cool to do. So let me recap. The five steps to start using configuration management. First, identify the time eaters. Well, then we kind of quick fix those to create time to actually implement configuration management. That's the third step. Start with a baseline. Try to keep it easy and get it actually started. Then scale out to all of your servers. Make sure every server is going to run configuration management. And then the real fun part starts to add more items to the mix to reach the final destination full control. So that's going to be fun. There's one more extra thing that I want to stress out one more time. Whatever happens, you should really use configuration management, because I believe this is the only way forward. This is the way to do it. And tell people that do a lot of manual work still, please spread the word, tell them they should stop doing that, because really, it doesn't make sense. So, that was the story for today. If you want to get in touch, you can either come talk to me or follow me on Twitter. I will post the slides soon, so you can look at them again. In fact, I have automated that part as well, so probably there should be a tweet flying by anytime soon now, if I got the time zones right. So we're going to see about that. You can also kind of talk to me later on. I'll be around for a couple of days. And maybe somebody has a question already right now, so feel free to do so.
Thanks, Remy. Remy is perfectly on time. Questions? I just want step five, relax. But okay. Questions?
It's the fifth phase anyway, so we can relax. Well, it was perfectly clear, I guess.
How do you tweet without using Twitter?
So you want to know about the automation tricks?
Yeah.
Well, Twitter has an API. So you could talk to it while you're not there.
So I have a tough one for you. You just joined Schuberg Phyllis, who is a pretty good configuration management DevOps shop.
Yes.
What do you think they are doing wrong?
What they're doing wrong? Well, we're on tape anyway. We're going all over the world, so I can safely say that.
One thing that you think that you know should be improved.
Well, when things start become more complicated, I thought about using Git as a version control system. And then it's in its very basic, you can just use one branch and then at least have a track record of what's going on. And I think where we can improve is maybe use a little bit more branches and have some extra testing, maybe add unit tests of stuff to automate when somebody changes a thing and it goes, for example, wrong, you want to know before it ever hits production. So I think that's one of the areas where we can improve.
Cool. One question? François?
One thing we do is, where I work, is that we use CF Engine, but we also use SaltStack more recently.
Mm-hmm.
And they have two approaches to configuration management. Actually, SaltStack does not define itself as primarily as a configuration manager.
Correct.
Such similar issue when dealing with cloud environments with CF Engine?
So if I understand you correctly, you're saying, well, when I'm using Chief Engine, it's actually a process which is running in the background, say every 5 minutes or maybe 15, you can configure it actually. So when you deploy a server, you gotta wait 5 minutes for it to kick in. What we did actually was using the user data in CloudSec. You can provide data to the VM at the point that you're when you're deploying it. So you're sending an API call to create it, and you put in an extra field. It's going to be a web server. And then we had in the template we had an init script that would pop up immediately when you're booting. That was reading that information and kick off Chief Engine to actually, or Chef or whatever, to have it configured it immediately. So then the 5 minute interval would only start after its first configuration, and then it would already be online. So that's an interesting thing to do, because the user data can be read from CloudSec once a server is booted. So then you can at least give some information and some data to it. You're supposed to do this or you're supposed to do that. It's different when you're, for example, using Chef, because Chef allows you to use, for example, the CloudSec Knife plugin that actually is able to talk directly to the VM once it's being created. So that's another way of doing it. So that you just combine the tools that are available and make it one automated process.
Cool, great. Well, thanks again, Remy, and let's go get a drink and cool. Take a break.
Thanks.
Thanks.